Hey, what up everybody? This is Stevie Breach coming to you. Today we're going to be traveling back to 2011. Honestly, I sort of was going to relive TLC and try and watch as many of these shows before it snuck up on us, but it's already Friday, and here I am reviewing 2011. On my channel, I only have a review of 2012 up. I came to find out I had never even watched 2013. But it doesn't look like I'm having enough time. The real short sort of span between Survivor Series and TLC before they go on their WWE Christmas break isn't that long, so looks like I'm only going to be able to relive this 1 year. I honestly sort of picked 2011, even though, you know, TLC spans back all the way to 2009, was mostly because I've had so many question marks this year rewatching the 2011 pay-per-views, sort of reliving what happened after CM Punk came back to WWE, and just trying to figure out, you know, what were they doing and did they have any plan on where they were going? Of course, with the, you know, Money in the Bank, he, you know, sort of spawns to become one of the biggest stars in professional wrestling, beats John Cena, leaves, comes back for SummerSlam, beats John Cena, gets cashed in against Alberto Del Rio, and they go on from there. Of course, he would re-win the title from Del Rio at Survivor Series in Madison Square Garden, and in this month, he has a ladder match against The Miz and against Alberto Del Rio for the WWE Championship. Sort of, I don't know, everybody really looks at The Miz as he was the champion for a good little while, and he had a good little run, but he never really was that sort of, like, you know, big star that nobody really thinks that. When The Miz was the champion, to me, I thought he was a big deal in WWE. I thought he was sort of that guy that when people would turn on the channel and they see he was holding the title, they would see his size, they see his physique, and they would say, you know, ah, that guy doesn't look like tough, I could beat him. And I thought that was sort of something that it would sort of bring in, you know, a lot of views because they want to see who's going to finally beat this guy up. He keeps on escaping month after month of the championship, and you just want to make sure you're there when this guy finally loses or rub it in his face. Somehow after the Miz finally lost the title to John Cena in that cage match against John Morrison, his stock started to lose a lot of value, and it's funny, you know, here we are years later, and they've never really even tried to rebuild it back up. Every once in a while, the Miz sort of, you know, gets a win. Like, he just had the Intercontinental title not that long ago, and he sort of was a guy that was sort of bringing some prestige to that, but again, he was the same guy who had it around WrestleMania 29, where he won it, I think, for a night. He won it at WrestleMania during the pre-show and lost it back to Barrett the next night. So, I don't know. With CM Punk, you can definitely, you know, hear a lot of the stuff that he talks about, you know, the 2011 run where basically Triple H came out of retirement to beat him for no apparent reason at all. And they've got something going from there. Of course, this would be his first pay-per-view defense after winning the championship at Survivor Series that led to that big, huge run where he held the title for so long. I guess he held it for over a year because he didn't lose it until the next year's Royal Rumble. But this show, it was a fun one to watch. I watched it over 2 days, and I think I watched it over a week ago. It's still pretty relevant in my mind about everything that happened. I would say go out and check this one out. Although 2011 doesn't really hold the most star power to it when people think of the best years of WWE. And then finally, the main event. In the main event, we saw CM Punk battle against The Miz and Alberto Del Rio. Twice in this match, we have to see CM Punk overcome being stupid enough to being handcuffed. Once to the ladder and once to the actual physical ring itself. As CM Punk is climbing up the ladder to grab the WWE Championship, Ricardo Rodriguez slips in from the outside, handcuffs CM Punk to the ladder. Punk is able to forcefully break the ladder to break himself free. Later on in the match, I think it's actually The Miz who does it. Miz grabs the handcuffs and handcuffs CM Punk again, this time to the actual ring corner. CM Punk has to actually physically take the ring apart as Miz and Del Rio are fighting on the ladder trying to get their way up there. Punk is able to dismantle the ring corner, which actually pops out of the ring and flies halfway across the way. I'd never seen a ring being taken apart, so I didn't know what it would do. Punk climbs up the ladder, beats both of these guys up. He's able to grab the championship and walks out of there as the champion. This was a good show. Like I said, you should honestly go and find a way to check this out. The rise and fall of CM Punk, I guess you can say. Maybe as we go on, maybe I'll start doing the 2012 shows as Punk holds the championship and talk about what he's doing, because it just seems that this guy should have been a much bigger deal. If you listen to both CM Punk interviews on the Art of Wrestling, it's something that, you know, really just says, well, he doesn't really say it, but, you know, he says it in other ways, and you have to put things together. Is, you know, basically after he re-signed with WWE, he fell out of love with wrestling. He hasn't watched it in so long. He just does it because that's his job. So we'll have to see, you know, we'll have to mark the one exact moment when he just said, fuck this, I made a big mistake coming back. During the CM Punk and UFC talks, he basically said that he wished he would have done this 3 years ago when he would have been 34 instead of 37. And then he'd be in a whole lot better shape to be going into this UFC career. See what happens.